Hello, I'm Richard Garriott de Cayeux, and I recently traveled to the bottom of the Mariana Trench, the deepest point in the ocean. And while I was down there, I collected some data so Matt could use maths to prove that this is the deepest maths video ever.
When I realized Richard was planning to go to the bottom of the Mariana Trench, a project which eventually made him only the 17th human to ever do so, and actually the first human who's been to space, and not this recent close enough is good enough lark. He did it old school on the ISS, several orbits. He's also been to both poles and the bottom of the ocean, first person to do all four. I was like, wow, okay, that's all well and good, but we could collaborate on the deepest maths video ever. The only problem is, how can we prove rigorously that this is the deepest maths video ever? And the answer is, of course, with some more maths. They were successful as well. Richard Garriott made it to the bottom of the Mariana Trench, and on the way down, this is what it looked like. Yeah, check that out. The blackness of the ocean. I mean, when they got to the bottom, they had lights, so you can see some sand and these crustacean things having a snack. That's kind of fun. But most of it looked like this. I mean, thank goodness the maths is so interesting. First up, some Mariana history, because while we're going to try and work out exactly how deep Richard went, we do know in general roughly how deep the Mariana Trench is, and we've known that since about the 1870s, when the British naval ship, the HMS Challenger, was pretty much just lowering a bit of string with a weight off the side, and be like, wow, that is a lot of string. And they specifically measured a bit called the Challenger Deep, which is named after the ship. So the Mariana Trench is named after the nearby Mariana Islands, and the Challenger Deep is just the deepest part of that trench. And I'll actually use Challenger Deep and Mariana Trench interchangeably, because the Challenger Deep just means the deepest bit. And ever since then, we've known it's really deep. So deep, in fact, no humans got down there until 1960, when Don Walsh and Jack Picard were the first humans to descend all the way down to the bottom of the ocean. An amazing achievement, both in terms of humankind's incredible lust for adventure and just scientific curiosity. And then the next person who went down was James Cameron. So no one from 1960 until 2012 bothered to go back down there, until movie director James Cameron built their own submersible and off they went. It's a bit like the moon in that regard, in that we went there for the sake of it in the 60s and then just didn't see a reason to go back, because, you know, we've checked it out, wasn't that exciting, and we may as well send robots. So it wasn't until film directors were like, I fancy this as a weird project, that we even bothered going back. So James Cameron was the third human to go to the bottom, and then the fourth human wasn't until 2019. Victor Vescovo went down in early 2019, and not only did they break the original depth record set by Don Walsh and Jack Picard back in 1960, but they basically cracked the technology. And it was the case now that suddenly, like, the risk and the costs had come down to the level where you could do this repeatedly, and they became the first human to do it more than once. In fact, they've gone up and down several times. They were driving the submersible when Richard went down to become the 17th person to make it to the bottom of the Mariana Trench. And so they've been going up and down like nobody's business, which is not to take away from just how difficult it is, because it is very deep. And I feel like I should explain with some useful analogies. To get a sense of the scale of the Mariana Trench, we're going to head down in my own submersible, one with an unrealistically big viewing window at the front, which would be incredibly dangerous at any kind of significant depth and pressure. But let's go with it anyway. So here we have sea level, that's the level where the sea is, and if we head on down, we have the Challenger Deep at the bottom of the Mariana Trench, which is on the order of 10,900 meters, give or take, almost 11 kilometers. So actually, if you're not a metric kind of person, almost 11 kilometers is like 6.8 miles, or 54.2 furlongs. There you are. It's actually, fun fact, 1.96 leagues. So I could have called this video almost 2 leagues under the sea, which sounds a bit underwhelming, if I'm being honest. Look, it's a long way. It's a long way down. If you were to get Mount Everest, which is the highest you can go on the Earth's surface above sea level, and that's 8,849 meters up, if you were to flip that, instead of going above sea level, go down from sea level, it wouldn't get to the Challenger Deep. What's almost 9,000 meters versus almost 11,000 meters? So the Challenger Deep, the greatest distance below sea level, is a bigger distance than going above sea level. And most ocean is not this deep. The average ocean depth on the Earth, give or take, 3,688 meters, which is almost exactly a third of the way down. How else to help? I mean, if you took the stairs, it would be over 49,000 stairs to get down there. That's the standard UK indoor stair size of 220 millimeters. I looked it up, the largest regulation stair you're allowed in a residential building in the UK. How else can I put this? It's like 5,891 lots of me. Look, I'm trying to make it sound big. Problem is, it's 11 kilometers. Like, that's actually not that. I mean, 11 kilometers, I can walk that in 2 hours. So it's a long way under the ocean, but it's not a long way. Like, horizontally, it's not much. Going up, it's not much. And Richard Garriott, he's been to space. He's been in low Earth orbit on the ISS. That's like 400 kilometers up. What's 11 kilometers down? But the big difference between going above the atmosphere versus going below the ocean is pressure.
Dear Lord, that's over 150 atmospheres of pressure. How many atmospheres can the ship withstand? Well, it's a spaceship, so I'd say anywhere between 0 and 1.
Pressure both causes and solves problems. In terms of causing problems, it's trying to kill you. It's trying to crush you as you descend to the bottom of the ocean, which is why Richard had to go down in a pressure-resistant vehicle, specifically the TRITON 36,000/2. So that's 36,000 for the number of feet below sea level it can travel, and /2 because it fits 2 people. There you are. I mean, if that slash was a divide, you get the number of feet descended per person, which is a meaningless calculation. But there you are. Fun name. And the actual TRITON 36,000 divided by 2 that Richard was in was named the DSV limiting factor, and it very safely got him to the bottom of the ocean. The key part keeping him safe is the kind of pressure vessel, I guess, but the pressure's on the outside, and that was a titanium alloy sphere with walls 9 centimeters thick. And they claim that the pressure bit is within 99.933% of sphericalness. That sounds pretty impressive, and it worked. So that's the downside to pressure, safety. The upside to pressure, when it's not trying to kill you, is it solves our problem of how do we calculate how deep Richard is in his submersible, the DSV limiting factor. And all we need to use is some integration. So I'm gonna head back to my submersible, the DSV Unrealistic. Yes, we are once again under the seas to have a look at pressure, which is pushing down on me, pressing down on you. So at the top, we've still got sea level, and then we're going to look at an entire column of water. So you can see here, I have drawn a cuboid. It's a rectangular prism of water. So at the top, that's a depth of 0, and then you go all the way down to here, we have some depth D, total depth. And we want to look at all the water in that column, how much force, therefore pressure, is it applying at the point D. And we're going to do that by integrating all the way down the column, which means we need to look at a little section of water partway down. So actually, I'm going to draw here I'm going to call it a cube. It might not be an exact cube. It's a small block of water part way down the cylinder. And if we zoom in on that cube, I'm going to label its height as some delta H, which just means a small change in height. I'm kind of picturing it moving down from the top towards the bottom. And there are different conventions. I think a lot of people use Z and they use negative for down. I'm using H and positive for down. Doesn't make a big difference. You've also got the area of that top section, some value A. I'm now going to give us a few useful formulae that will come in very handy later on. So I'm going to say that the volume of some little cuboid like that just equals the area times its height. The mass of a cube like that equals the density of whatever's in it times its volume. The force resulting from that, well, force is just mass times acceleration, and pressure equals the amount of force you've got divided by the total area it's applied over. Now we get down to business. So the small change in volume, which is, I just mean a small bit of volume. I say change because I'm imagining as you go down, but it's just a tiny chunk of volume equals whatever that area is times a little bit of the height, which means that the little bit of mass represented by this one section equals whatever the density is times the area times a little bit of height, which means the tiny bit of force we get from this one little cube, well, that's the above mass times acceleration. And the acceleration in this situation is just gravity. That's what's pressing down or pushing. And so that means it's g for acceleration due to gravity times rho, the density, times area times a small bit of height. And finally, the little bit of pressure coming from that one cube, well, that just equals the force divided by the area. So that area cancels out quite nicely. So it's g times rho times a little bit of height. Now, to get it for the entire column, we just integrate the whole way down. So we integrate one side, dp, equals integrate the other side, g rho dh. I switched to d just to mean, you know, infinitesimal, like absolutely tiny. And actually g and rho, if they're constants, then that's a dead easy integration. We just get that pressure equals gravity times density times the total depth, d. And we're done. You know what? Just to double check, I am going to do a dimensional analysis later on where I get all the units and work through to make sure that equation works. But I'm going to put that on Patreon. So if you support me on Patreon, you can check that out. It feels like real niche stuff. And I don't think this main video is going to be any worse off for not having it. What I will do here, though, is put some numbers into that so we can get a bit of a sense check on, does that work? And minor spoiler, I can tell you that the total pressure, well, rather the maximum pressure that Richard experienced was 112,495,000 pascal, which you could do in kilopascal. Pascal is actually easier for doing the calculation afterwards. Acceleration due to gravity, well, that's 9.81, that's it, meters per second squared. The density of seawater, on average, is around 1,028 kilograms per cubic meter. And then we just divide the pressure by g and rho. And if you actually crunch that all through, d, I'm just going to separate off, d equals 11,155 meters. So that's just over 11 kilometers. That's too big. We've gone too far. We've made a mistake. We haven't made a mistake, we've just made an inaccurate assumption. I've rolled us back to where we just had this integral, and the mistake was assuming that g here is constant, and assuming that rho here is constant. So g, for a start, changes depending on how much of the Earth is below you to accelerate you. So as the submersible goes down, there's now mass above as well as mass below. So what we'd need to do is go right back to the force due to gravity equals big G, good old dependable big G, that's a constant, times the mass of the Earth times the mass of the submersible divided by the radius squared. And the acceleration due to that, we can just take out the mass. But then the mass of the Earth, you can discount the shells above, but you've got to recalculate the amount of mass still below you as you go down. And I guess above you is more water and below you is more rock on average. And then that radius, that's now the radius of the Earth subtract the distance you've gone down. So technically, g is a function of depth. And rho is also a function of depth. So when people are actually doing these oceanographic calculations, they switch the density to be the specific volume, which is just 1 over the density, and they call that alpha. And then they split that into two parts. They say that the main alpha equals alpha naught, which is like the 1028 kilograms per cubic meter, like the standard amount. And then they add on the extra factor, which depends on all sorts of things. It depends on the temperature at, it depends on the salinity. It depends quite a lot on the pressure that you're currently under. And they split it out as two bits because it actually makes the integration easier, because seawater can be compressed. So as you go down this column towards the bottom, it's getting much, much more compressed, which is why, if that's a big factor, we overestimated the depth. Because we were assuming the water wasn't compressed, which means it takes up more space, which means we were assuming for the same pressure, it's a much longer column of water. Although the gravity, that goes the other way, because we assumed gravity was the same strength. Gravity is actually weaker, which means you need a bigger column. So it's bigger than what we thought. So actually, we've got different factors going in different directions, and they all change how you convert from pressure to depth. And a lot of them, you can't get a nice equation that, like, what's the equation for how the salinity varies as you go down in the ocean? So I think to go any further, I'm gonna have to speak to an expert. I spoke to Samuel Greenaway at the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, or NOAA, for short. It's like the ocean version of NASA. And Samuel sent me a copy of this amazing bit of scientific research, which is currently in press, which means it's all finalized. It's just waiting to be officially published. So the moment it's out, I will link to it in the description because it is so on brand for what we're trying to do here. It is titled Revised Depth of the Challenger Deep from Submersible Transects, Including a General Method for Precise Pressure-Derived Depths in the Ocean. I mean, incredible. And this was only possible because Vescovo was going up and down so many times in 2020 and making all that data freely available to scientists that Samuel Greenaway and fellow scientists Catherine D. Sullivan, S. Harper Umfres, Alice B. Beetle, and Carl D. Wagner were able to analyze that data and update the way calculations are done to get depth from pressure. Amazing. And so do check this paper out when it's finally released. I had a lot of fun flicking through it. I mean, the maths I enjoyed, the rest of it, it's got pretty charts. But I asked them for a summary and they sent through this, which is a list of their top 7 confounding factors you need to compensate for when calculating ocean depth from pressure.
It's the top 7 confounding factors you need to compensate for when calculating ocean depth from pressure. Coming in at number 1, compressibility of seawater.
Yep, the amount that seawater compresses as you get more and more pressure can change your calculation of depth by up to 300 meters. So that's definitely worth factoring in. That's why it's number 1.
Number 2, gravity as a function of latitude.
Yeah, gravity changes because we live on a spinning oblate spheroid. So your latitude, or how far up from the equator you are, changes the local acceleration due to gravity to the tune of 50 meters in your final result.
3, in situ density of the column of seawater.
This is everything else that changes the density, the salinity, so all the stuff that's dissolved in the water, and the temperature combined, they can mess you up by 8 meters.
4, surface gravity anomaly.
Sounds scary. 4 meters.
5, gravity gradient anomaly.
This was the one thing I could factor in, and it turns out it only makes a difference of 1 to 2 meters. So, barely worth it. Speaking of which.
6, local water levels such as tides, and 7, local atmospheric pressure.
Tides, 0.5 meter, atmospheric pressure at the surface, 10 centimeters. So, if you really want to get pedantic, double check the atmospheric pressure before you dive. Because the density of the water has such a huge impact on your final depth calculation, and because it varies so much and fairly unpredictably, it depends on how much salt and what temperature things happen to be, as the DSV limiting factor was descending, they just took constant measurements of their surroundings. And Richard's team very kindly sent me all of their data from the descent, which of course I have put into a spreadsheet. So the first column over here, column A, that's just the lapsed time. So that is how many seconds. So starting at 0 seconds, and then they recorded their data every 10 seconds as they were descending. You've then got the pressure in D-bar. One D-bar is about 10 kilopascals. Or 10,000 pascals. So you better believe I converted that. You've then got the conductivity. This is how they were able to measure the amount of dissolved salts, by seeing how the conductivity of the water changed. They've also then got the temperature in degrees Celsius. And they're the four kind of directly measured values. Everything else is derived from those. So taking the measured pressure and conductivity and temperature, they could convert that into a density measurement. This is given in specific gravity, so it's just relative to pure water. I view it, it's 1,000th of the number of kilograms per cubic meter. And to get that, they used a thing called the Gibbs SeaWater Oceanographic Toolbox, which is just a whole bunch of really funky formulae that you can use when you're calculating things involving seawater. I will link to it below. I think the actual function they use for this has got like 75 terms in it or something ridiculous. I decided that was a Pandora's box of formulae I wasn't going to open in this video, but you can look into it if you want. And they've also got the speed of sound in the water, because you can also measure depth by using sonar, but this makes a difference. Also, their communication with the surface had to be done by sending effectively sonar through the water. And so the speed of sound was quite important. We're not going to use it for our purposes. And the very first thing I did over here, you can just see I calculated a few values. Oh, that's the minimum temperature. They got down to 1.4 degrees. Very interesting for water. And I got the max pressure. So the max pressure was 112,000 kilopascals, which is 1,110 times atmospheric pressure. Isn't that insane? They were at 1,000 times atmospheric pressure. Just absolutely bonkers. And the max density was all the way out at 1.0747. So that's roughly that's 3 times more than the normal increase in salt water compared to fresh, but now I realize that's a insufficiently precise statement, so let's ignore that. So anyway, I took all the data, and the first thing I did after I worked out the min and max values, I plotted it. So there you are. There's your plot. So, what a plot. Nice and predictable. So this is the pressure, time on the horizontal axis. Pressure obviously races up as they're descending, and then plateaus while they're at the bottom. And then you can see here, they took longer coming back up than they took going down. And so there you are, what a fantastic plot. And I could then use this to try and calculate the depth they went to. So over here is where I've actually analyzed the data. And you know what, I will zoom back in on that so you can see it a bit more clearly. So I took all the values they gave me. I then worked out the average density between each of the measurement points, because I took the one data point to the next one to be one block of water I wanted to calculate the integral for. I then worked out the pressure change across that block, and then I use it to calculate the depth change. And I've just used the formula from before, but instead of integrating it properly, I've just numerically integrated it at each step. So for each step, I just worked out, for that average density, for the pressure to have changed this much, what must the depth change have been in meters? And then over here, I just add them up. And so finally here, that final depth, negative 35 meters, that's either a calibration slip or it's the fact that they lifted it right out of the water when they got back. Who knows? But anyway, here's my plot of the depth, and that max depth right there, 10,896 meters. That's my final prediction. The one extra compensation I did put in local gravity. So I worked out for the latitude of the Challenger Deep, gravity is a little bit less. And actually, that number over here is if I didn't factor in gravity. So factoring in local gravity actually increased the depth by an extra 30 meters. So I felt like that was worth putting in. So there you are. That's my final call. I'm going to round that to be, I say that Richard went to a depth of 10,897 meters. Let's find out what the correct answer was.
Hey Matt, Richard here. I can confirm, according to my little certificate, that our official depth on March 1st was 10,925 meters. What did you get?
I calculated Richard's final depth to be 10,897 meters, and we now know it was officially 10,925, which means I was only off by 28 meters. I was within 0.26% of the actual depth of this maths video. And now that Greenaway's paper has actually been published, I can reveal the new official depth of the Challenger Deep is 10,935 meters, plus or minus 6 meters at 95% confidence interval. So frankly, a video about mathematics can't get much more deep.
Okay, that's not bad. Working it out with a spreadsheet, pretty darn close. Huge thanks to Richard Garriott and all of their team for making this data available for me and sending me all the footage. Actually, if you want to download the data yourself, I have a link to the spreadsheet below. Teachers, you can use it in your classroom. And finally, while Richard and Victor had several hours to fill, going all the way down, coming all the way back up again, they answered some other questions people had sent in, one of which is quite relevant to this video.
Hey, Mr. Parker, I am down here in the submarine limiting factor with Victor Vishkovo, who kindly took us all the way down to the depths of the Mariana Trench down in the Challenger Deep. And we are returning now back from the surface. But now that we've just been to the deepest place on Earth, you offered some really fun challenges to hand out to folks. And that is, one question is while we're down there at the bottom of the Challenger Deep, are we at the closest place to the center of the Earth?
No.
Ah, no, we're not. And so, Victor, where is the place on this Earth that you could go that is the closest to the center of the Earth?
Actually, that's been subject to some discussion over the last 30 days with my chief geologist for my expedition. We thought it might have been at the deepest point in the Arctic Ocean, the Molloy Deep. But actually, we've now theorized that the lowest point closest to the center of the Earth is actually in a place called the Gackel Trench, which is under the Arctic ice sheet in the Arctic Ocean, and no one has ever been there.
Excellent. Oh, and so, by the way, this place that I'd heard of, the Litka Deep.
It's close to the Litka Deep. Litka Deep, we now believe, is actually slightly shallower than the Gackel Trench.
Wow. Oh, excellent.
It's possible.
I knew that we were asking the right guy. Down here with the right guy to know the answer to this question. And by the way, I did bring down with me a Parker Square, which I'll be sending to you later.
Right. Two things to unpack there. First of all, yes, the Challenger Deep is not the point closest to the center of the Earth. It is the point that's the deepest compared to sea level, but because we live on a spinning oblate spheroid, if you're closer to the pole, you start closer to the center of the Earth, which is why there's a different point which isn't as deep compared to sea level, but is closer to the center of the Earth. It's a bit like Everest is the highest point you can reach above sea level, but it's not the point that's the closest to space. There's a mountain in Ecuador, which because it's closer to the equator, starts further up, like sea level is closer to space. And so its peak is technically above Everest. But that's a topic for a different video I hope to make one day. More importantly, the second thing to unpack is yes, on their journey to the deepest point in the Earth's ocean, Richard did take with them a Parker Square. They drew it on a styrofoam drinking cup, which started regular size, but because Richard stored this on the outside of the pressure vessel, it was subjected to, as we saw a thousand times, atmospheric pressure, which compressed it. But there it is, official Parker Square, drawn in, I would say, almost an insulting level of accurate detail, was taken to the bottom of the Earth's ocean. So this, the Parker Square, is now officially the deepest bit of maths ever. Very importantly though, Richard brought this bit of litter back up with them, which is not always the case. So it was actually Victor on one of their earlier trips to the bottom of the Mariana Trench who saw at the deepest point in the Earth's ocean, a plastic bag. There you are. I mean, it shouldn't be that surprising. There's a lot of plastic in the ocean and plastic sinks. It's not like it sinks after a while. It's like, oh, I'm sick of sinking and stops. So there's just plastic everywhere, including the deepest point, which is why this video is part of the Team Seas initiative. So loads of videos have all been released about the ocean simultaneously. This has been organized by Mr. Beast and Mark Rober. And Mark sent me a message a while ago saying they were lining this up. I was like, oh my goodness, I have all this footage and maths about the Mariana Trench that would tie in perfectly. So the Team Seas project is an attempt to get 30 million pounds of plastic waste out of the Earth's oceans and indeed beaches and rivers, because it's going to end up in the ocean anyway. And they're trying to raise $30 million to make that possible. And for every dollar they raise, it will go to a not-for-profit organization who will then remove 1 pound of plastic. I'm aware none of that's in metric, and a pound of plastic is 0.4536 grams. And it's in dollars too, US dollars. So, I mean, it's a bit less catchy, but technically, for every 73 pence that's donated, they'll remove 453.6 grams of plastic. Not as, okay, it's 30 million pounds of plastic removed for $30 million. I'm gonna be donating all the revenue generated by this video to the Team Seas project. I encourage you to spread the word, and if you can, donate as well, and we'll try to make it so when future people go to the bottom of the Earth's ocean, it's not covered in plastic.